want you to turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5 as we've been this year going to be looking at a series called Transformation, and that God wants to transform us. He wants to change us. How is God going to change us? It's going to come different ways at different times. None of us are going to know exactly when God is going to change us, but God is in the changing business. But how many know God can't change you unless you want to change? You know, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. You can set the table, you can prepare everything, but if people don't want to change, no one's going to change them. God can't even change us unless we want to be changed. And I remember back in January of 2016, and I was a Diet Coke guy, and I loved Diet Coke, and it was during the first 40 days of 2016 when we were fasting, and I was fasting food, but I gave up caffeine, and had no caffeine for 40 days, and it was during that time that I didn't have any Diet Cokes, and I was like a 2 or 3, 4, 5, 6 Diet Cokes a day type of guy, thinking that it was doing me healthy. You know, I was healthy taking all that Diet Coke. But the reality was that I gave it up for the fast, and I never went back. I haven't had a Diet Coke since January 2016. At times I miss it, the reality is I changed my diet. I changed my appetite. And God wants to change us, but we have to be willing to be able to change as well. How many have ever heard the statement, you are what you eat? Some of you look, well, I won't go there. But you know, you are what you eat. What you put in is going to come out. And if you eat healthy, you're going to be healthy. If you eat unhealthy, you're going to be unhealthy. If you eat ding-dongs and Twinkies all day long, you're not going to be very healthy. But if you eat salad and tofu and all that rabbit food, they say you're going to be healthy. I don't know if it's true, but I just know that's the saying, what you eat, you are what you eat. And you know, you can tell a person if he's healthy because they have a healthy appetite. And you can tell the moment somebody is sick, maybe your child, or maybe you've gone through the flu, and the first thing that goes, you don't have an appetite when you're sick. You don't have a desire for food. You look at food and you don't want anything to do with it. And it's the same way in our spiritual life. You can tell people that are spiritually healthy by the appetite that they have. That they have an appetite for God's word. They have an appetite for praise. They have an appetite for worship. They have an appetite for prayer. They have an appetite for ministry. They have an appetite because they're spiritually healthy. And you can tell people that are not spiritually healthy because there's no appetite for the word. They're never in the word. You can tell them that they're not in church. They're not involved in ministry. They don't enter into worship. And I want to have a physically, spiritually healthy appetite for the things of God. I want to give God the best that I have. I don't want to give him the leftovers. I want to give him everything I have, because an appetite determines the health of an individual. I put it on Facebook last night. What are you hungry for? And I had the spiritual answers, but then I had a pastor friend of mine, he put on there, I know I should say Jesus, but it was about 10 o'clock last night. He says, I'm really hungry for a pizza. And then Pastor Pablo focused on that and says, yeah, I really should have Jesus, but I want a pizza too. But then he turned it around at the end. There was somebody else from ICC that put on there, I'm really hungry for tamales. And they had a whole list of stuff they wanted to put on the tamales. And they said, man, that's what I'm hungry for. I don't know what you're hungry for today, but I pray that we're hungry for the next 25 minutes, that we're hungry for the things of the Lord, because God wants to change our appetite, and he's teaching us how to climb the ladder. He's trying to teach us how we change on the inside. And after church, after the third service, and I'm hungry, I'll pick up Emma, and we'll go out in the car, and this will be our conversation. Well, what are you hungry for? And she'll look at me, what are you hungry for? And then I'll look at her, what are you hungry for? The good old husband, wife, you go back and forth. But then if we say, well, we're hungry for breakfast, then we'll either go to the Island Coffee Shop, we'll go to Mike's, we'll go to Z1, we'll go for breakfast. If we're hungry for Italian, we're going to go to Joe and Pat's. If we're hungry for hamburgers, we end up going to Five Guys, because we're going to go whatever we're hungry for. And how many know in the spiritual sense, you go for where you're hungry for, and what you need is where you will find behind it. And our appetite will determine what we will eat. A.W. Tozer said, we can have as much of God as we want. It's a buffet. You can have as much of God as you want, and you can have as little of God as you want. It's not dependent on God giving me more. It's depending on my appetite. It's depending on my thirst. It's depending on the cravings of my spirit. Listen to what David said in Psalm 42. He says in verses 1 and 2, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When can I go and meet with God? Not this idea, now I have to go meet with God, but now I need to get to meet with God. I need to have His fill my life with His presence. He said over in Psalm 84 in verse 2, my soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. David thirsts and longed for God. And that's what we're seeing in Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Blessed are those who what? Hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. He's not talking about a little hunger pain that maybe you're getting a little hungry and the stomach growls a little bit and you can't wait to get a little donut to fill that emptiness. No, he's talking about a desperation. He's talking about hunger. He's talking about people who their bellies are so protruded because they haven't eaten. And if they don't eat, they're gonna die. He's not talking about a little thirst where, you know, man, I need a little drink to fill me up. But no, he's talking about a thirst that if they don't get water, they're going to die. And there are too many Christians who all they want is a little dab will do you. They want a little service, a little thing, just to satisfy their own desires. But God is saying, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Oh, one of my former district superintendents from Southern New England, Ed Berkey, said this, it is not the sin and the world that makes me upset, as the apathy and the worldliness that is in the church. Boy, we get awful upset with the sin out there, those bad, bad sinners. He says, no, the reality is, it's bad. We better get concerned about what's going on in the house of God. It's the apathy, it's the lack of desire, it's the lack of hunger. Friends, why would the sinner, why would the world out there want what we have if we're not satisfied in who Jesus is? Why would the world want to have the Jesus that we have if there is no joy, if there's no peace, if there's no contentment, if there's no faith? Why would people want to serve a Jesus that makes no difference in our everyday life? The reality is every one of us is hungry after something. Every one of us has an appetite for something. Every one of us has a craving for something. And what are we going to do with the cravings that we have in our lives? Friends, what you're craving? Oh, maybe your craving is happiness. And you're going to do anything to fill the emptiness of your life. Maybe some of you are going to shop until you drop. And you say, man, if I can only buy one more thing, then I will be happy. Or maybe if I get better looking and get in shape, I'll be happy. If happiness is your craving, you will never be happy, because when you get there, it will always let you down. Maybe your happiness, your craving is possessions. And you say, man, if only I could get a bigger home, then my life will have meaning. Or if I have more money, or if I have another title or another degree. Thank God for education, but let me say, how many titles and degrees do you need to be satisfied? You can have another degree on the wall, but that degree will never fill the emptiness of your life. Some of you say, well, if I had more pleasure, you know, my life is just the grind of going through life. And I said, man, if I only had more pleasure, man, pleasure will never leave you filled. It will always lead to more. I mean, maybe you're in this room and maybe you're not married, and you say, man, if only I could have sex and my life would be satisfied. And friends, let me tell you, sex outside of marriage will never satisfy you. You can go from here to there, you can buy it, you can rent it, you can watch it, you can do everything. It will never satisfy. It will always leave you empty. But in marriage it is blessed. Can I have an amen? Maybe it's ministry, and say, I need more ministry and more. Friends, if it's not from the Holy Spirit, then what are you craving for? Oswald Chambers said this about the Beatitudes. The first time we read the Beatitudes, they seem to be beautiful and simple statements, and they go unobserved in the subconscious mind. We are so used to the words of Jesus that they slip right over us. unheeded, they sound sweet and pious and wonderfully simple, but they are in reality like spiritual torpedoes that burst and explode in the subconscious. We realize what startling words they really are. He is saying the average Christian needs some spiritual torpedoes to go off in their spiritual life. That's what he says, torpedo number one. Blessed are the poor in spirit. He is saying we need to have a torpedo that says, man, I'm not all who I think I am. That I am poor. That I can't do it. That I can't make it without him. That I'm just a spiritual beggar. Man, we need a Jesus to get saved, but sometimes the longer we're saved, Jesus comes along for the ride. Jesus is not your co-pilot. Jesus is the pilot. He is the Lord. He is the Savior. He is the Master. And if I need a torpedo that says I'm poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. It's the next step up. Lord, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. It's not saying, well, you know, I'm under grace and it doesn't matter how I live. Let me tell you, we need a torpedo that goes off in our spirit, man, that says my sin is an abomination to God. Well, maybe I don't commit murder, but I hate somebody in my heart. He says it's murder. And we're going to talk about that in a few weeks. He talks about, you know, if I don't commit adultery, but if I lust after a woman, I've committed adultery in my heart. He's saying, I got to get to the point where a torpedo goes off that, Lord, I am a wicked man, that woe is me, for I'm unclean, that I'm not where I need to be, that I can dress okay on the outside. I can wear a suit and tie. I can dress a certain way, but on the inside, my heart is wickedly filthy and deceitful above all things. And we need a torpedo where I grieve over my own sin. I says, God, it's me. It's me that stands in the need of prayer. Then we talked about blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And that's referring to a torpedo of our relationship and how we deal with people and how we get along with our husbands, our wives, our children, how we get along with our neighbors. How do people think of us? Do they want to be around us? Do people love us? Am I forgiving? If I'm going to be a person of meekness, then I need to say, Lord, let that torpedo go off. But then in verse 6, the torpedo that I am satisfied, blessed are those who hunger. Can you enjoy life right where you're at today? How many want to be blessed? Oh, we think of blessed, oh God, send the money in. You know, some of you will be destroyed if God sent the money in. Oh God, man, if I had this, I'd be blessed. You know what blessed means? Is Lord, it's me and you alone, God. That, oh God, you're enough for me. Can you have the joy of the Lord even in unhappy situations? Friends, if you want the blessing of God, it always comes down to the choices that we make. When Jesus gave the Beatitudes, they have a condition in them. The promises of God are conditional. It's not like a good luck charm or a lucky rabbit's foot or a genie in a bottle. But God's promises are always conditional. How many want God's blessing? You want the blessing? You got to meet the conditions. Can I have an amen? Keep your finger in Deuteronomy, but turn over to in Matthew, but turn to Deuteronomy chapter 28. Now listen to God's word. This is what God's word says. Deuteronomy 28, verse 1. Look at the first 5 or 6 words. If you, well, I do it to the degree that I can. Well, I do it on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. But Saturdays and Sundays, I do my own thing. No, it says if you fully, that means with everything you have. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow some, all of his commands. All of his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on the earth. Listen to what it says, verse 2. All these blessings will come on you. How many want the blessings of God? And accompany you if, there's the condition, you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city. How many, oh God, bless New York City. Man, God can bless you no matter where you live, whether you live in the city or whether you live in the country. Friends, God's blessings is good in the Dominican Republic, Romania, Zimbabwe, and it's good in New York City and in America. And friends, God is the one that makes America great again. You'll be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed. Man, how many want to say, God, bless my children, bless my grandchildren. I pray that now, you know, that Cheryl's no longer, God, bless my grandchildren. They have a disadvantage, but God, make up a difference in their life. You will, the fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land, and the young of your livestock, the calves of your herds, and the lambs of your flock. How many want their businesses to succeed? I get connection cards. Pray that God will bless my business. You want to bless your business? You start giving to God and obeying God, and God will bless your business. He will make a way where there seems to be no way. He says, verse 5, your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in, and you will be blessed when you go out. How many can, Lord, bless me. The Lord will grant that the enemies who rise up against you will be defeated before you. They will come at you from one direction, but they will flee from you in seven. Can somebody say amen? The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hand to. The Lord God will bless you in the land he's giving you. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath, if you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him. Then all the people of the earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and that they will fear you. The Lord will grant you, I love this, abundant prosperity. Wow. Not just prosperity. Abundant prosperity in the fruit of your womb. He says, I'm going to bless your children. Your children may be living like the devil right now, but if you will walk in obedience to God, God says, I will bless the fruit of your womb. I will bring them back. I will save them. I will draw them back if you walk in obedience. God's not going to bless my children and grandchildren if I'm not walking in obedience to God. But when I walk in obedience to God, the blessing of God will be poured out into their life. Oh, verse 12, the Lord will open the heavens. Oh, God, open the heavens over ICC. The storehouse of his bounty to send rain on your land in season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from no one. The Lord will make you the head and not the tail if you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them. You will always be at the top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them. If I do my part, God will always do his part. But if I don't do my part, it doesn't matter who anoints you. You can go and pray over some, you say, oh man, I want somebody to come and anoint me. I want somebody to put a word over my life. Let me tell you, you don't need a word over your life. You don't need to buy some holy oil or holy feathers or holy handkerchiefs. You don't need to buy that stuff. You need to say, God, I'm going to walk in obedience to you. And when I walk in obedience to you, you will open the windows of heaven over my life. Friends, don't give it to somebody else. Give it to the Lord and says, God, I'm going to walk in obedience to you. But look at verse 15. However, if you do not obey the Lord your God and do not carefully follow all his commands and decrees, I'm giving you today, all these curses will come on you and will overtake you. The choice is up to you and me. You can't say, well, oh God, I'm under a curse. You're under a curse because you're walking under disobedience. Nobody else can put you under a curse. Oh, I'm under a generational curse. Let me tell you, when Jesus died, he took the curse and nailed him to the old rugged cross. And he that the Son has set free is free indeed. And I don't need to walk around under a curse. Well, I'm just cursed to be a failure. No, when I walk in obedience to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, then I will be the head and not the tail, that the enemy has no power over me, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The truth is I determine the amount of the blessing of God in my life by the actions that I choose. How do I change? How do I change? How do I get transformed? Let me give you a couple of words this morning in Matthew chapter 5. How do we change our appetite? First of all, it's the cravings of the Spirit. Blessed are those who what? Hunger and thirst. Am I hungry and am I thirsty? Am I desperate? That word hunger means to crave for. It means to toil after. It means that I am starving to the point that I will do anything I can to get to it. It means to yearn after it. Like the Patriots in the second half last week. They wanted it a little more. They desired it. I had to bring one in. In the first half, it was all over. When Brady threw the interception, I says, this game's over. Patriots are going to lose. Falcons are going to win. Man, everybody was chirping on Facebook to me. You know, parties were going on. They were going to call. Patriots are going down. Patriots are going down. Patriots are going down. And I knew it was going to come because I thought the Patriots were dead. But it's never over until it's over. And it's never over in our spiritual life unless we have desire. See, in the parts of the world today, they were desperate. They're desperate for food. They're desperate. I was thinking of the well that we put in the village in Zimbabwe a couple of years ago that ICC put in. And I talked with the missionary, and the missionary said, you know, because of the whole village coming to get water, they never had a clean, pure water. But now that they have the well, every day at 5 a.m., they come with their buckets, and they fill their buckets with water, and they go back to their village, that the church has grown so much that this little church that we built, the well, the tabernacle, they have gone to another village and now they're starting another church. What? All because there were people that were hungry and thirsty and the church was able to meet the need. And Jesus is saying, how desperate are we for the Lord? You know, in America, we say, well, we're desperate, but are we really desperate? Are we really hungry? Or have we become complacent in our spiritual life? Have we gone to the point that we're lukewarm, that we're falling from our first love? Are we empty and just going through the motion? There's no desperation. There's no urgency. There's no fervency in our spiritual life. There's no desire to reach our families and to reach our neighbors. There's no desire. There's no hunger. There's no desperation. What are the cravings of the Spirit? A craving is something that you want so bad that you will do anything to get it. If you've been married and your wife has been pregnant, you'll know that at all strange hours of the night, they'll have cravings. And no matter what time it is, you better go and get that ice cream or those pickles or tamales or whatever, because she has a craving. That craving is not going to go away until you get that thing. Friends, God is saying you need a craving. You need a craving for my presence. What is the cravings of our life? Maybe a craving is man's sports. Maybe it's retirement. Maybe it's a new house or a new car or a great vacation. There's nothing wrong with those. We need a plan. We need to save. We need to do all those things. But friends, our first craving must be, Lord, I want you. I need your presence, Lord. Maybe your craving is in this place. You can't wait for the next fix, and you're waiting for the next crack or heroin. Maybe it's cigarettes or alcohol or pornography or gambling. And maybe it's addictions, whatever your appetite. That's what you're going to go after. And friends, those appetites can change in our life. How many remember King David? He was a man who was chosen by God to be the anointed king of Israel. And David was in the backside of the wilderness taking care of a few sheep. And it was there that David practiced his worship. And he began to sing and learn how to worship God. Not for anybody. Worship is not about Facebook. It's not about live stream. It's not about what anybody else. My worship is between me and God, because we can sing up here. But if it's only singing, that's it. But God is looking for worship. And David, listen, with a few sheep, began and learned to worship God. He learned how to practice his slingshot. He began to practice out in the wilderness. And when he faced Goliath, he was able to defeat Goliath. Why? Because he trained himself in the secret place. And friends, God is saying, what are you craving in the secret place? David came back and he was now king. Instead of going out to war, he says, I've done my duty. Now I'm just going to take it easy now. I'm just going to sit back, take it easy, chill out. You know, I'm getting close to retirement. I don't want to go out there with the young guys. I can't keep up with them anymore. And David stood back and he went up on his roof at night. And on the next house, Bathsheba was out there, a beautiful young woman who was bathing naked. And he had a desire. He began to crave her. He began to have an appetite for her. And he says, you go get that woman for me. And his servant says, no, she's a married woman. He says, I don't care. I have this desire. I want Bathsheba. Bathsheba came. He slept with her. She became pregnant. We know the story that he called her husband in from battle. How he had him killed because he wouldn't sleep with her. Friends, let me tell you, we're going to go after the things that we desire in life. And that's why David said in Psalm 42, as the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul panteth after you. And if we would be real today, how many of us have no desire for the deeper things of God? St. Augustine said, the heart of man is restless until he finds his rest in God. We read the book of Ecclesiastes, and Ecclesiastes was, Solomon was the Donald Trump of his day. He was the wealthiest, he had everything, and Solomon went through, in the book of Ecclesiastes, he tried all these things to fill the emptiness of his life. He tried to say, man, if I had more work. He became a workaholic. He worked hours after hours after hours, and when he did the work, he says, it's all meaningless. He says, man, he had 1,000 concubines. Can you imagine that? 1,000 women. He had 1,000 women, and 1,000 women couldn't satisfy him. He had building projects. He had hobbies. He had all these things. And when you read the book of Ecclesiastes, he says, none of these things will satisfy. None of these things will make it real. None of these things will make a difference in our lives. You look at people in our world today who have everything, and on the outside, they may look like their act is all together, but on the inside, they're empty, they're hurting. How many remember Elvis Presley? Elvis Presley grew up in an Assemblies of God church in Nashville, Tennessee, and he began singing in the choir, but then he got his break, and he began singing, and he began to sing, and he began to take care of himself, and the reality is, he ended his life. Why? Because he wasn't satisfied. How many remember Kurt Cobain? He played for a group called Nirvana, but he killed himself because he was empty. How about Marilyn Monroe? How about all these other people? I can go all the way up to today that they have everything on the outside, but on the inside, there is nothing. They are empty. They're not satisfied. And God is saying all over our city, there are people who walk to work. They get on the ferry. They get on the bus. They go in, but they're searching. They're struggling. They're empty. They're broken. They're looking for something. But the church is so empty of the presence of God that we have nothing to give them. And Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man opens the door, I will come in. And I will satisfy the craving of their hearts. Oh, but number two, the object of the craving. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after what? Righteousness. What are we hungering after? What's our desire? How many of us are craving righteousness? Now, what is righteousness? Righteousness can only happen in one of two ways. Number one, it's my righteousness, and I try to live a good, righteous, moral life. How many have ever tried that? That's called, you know, I'm going to legalism. And so I wear the right clothes. I do everything right. You know, on the outside, I look like everything's fine. I come to church. I put my offering in. I serve the Lord. I wear my suit coat. I do everything that everybody expects of me to do. But the reality is, all of my righteousness is as filthy rags. There is nothing that I can do in myself that's going to impress God. I can try to impress you, but I can't impress God. I can't say, God, look at how good I am. I am and all that I've done. God is not interested in how good I am. Isaiah said in Isaiah 6, woe is me, for I am unclean. I am undone. I am wicked. He says, my righteousness is as filthy rags. That filthy rag was something that was misused. It was something that was dirty, and it was thrown into the trash. And God is saying, the best that you can do is not good enough. Can I have an amen? Oh, we try to live a holy life. We try earning our salvation. We try at working, pleasing God. We live by all the rules and all the morals, and we do everything that we think we should, but I can't save myself. I couldn't save myself, and I can't keep myself saved. The same Jesus that had to save me is the same Jesus that needs to keep me. Friends, that I can't please God. Friends, it says in Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for it is by grace. For it is by grace, by grace, by grace that you have been saved. Through faith, for this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that what? No man can boast. It's always coming back. I'm a sinner saved by grace. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for seeing something in my life. Thank you, Lord, that I can't please you. I don't care how long you've been in the church. I don't care how long you've been a member of ICC. I don't care what position you have. If your heart is not right, then you are not right with God. Serving Jesus should not be a struggle. It's not about what I got to do. It's like getting on that treadmill. No, serving Jesus is receiving the wonderful grace of God. See, the object of my craving cannot be my righteousness, because my righteousness will fail. But my righteousness must be in Christ's righteousness. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 16, Paul, he was a religious dude. He knew what to do. He lived the right way. He was a Jew of Hebrew of Hebrews. He was educated. He had it all together. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16, he says this: so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Boy, that would be revival right there. How many Christians are good at looking at other people saying, look at what they are, look what they are, look what they are, look what they do, look at their sin, look at their sin. Oh, they had a marriage failure. Oh, they did this, they did this. They lie, they cheat, they steal, they smoke, they do drugs. And we look at people from a worldly point of view. We look at them from a wrong perspective. Can I have an amen? Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation is come. The old is gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. We're not to be knocking people down and criticizing and judging people, but we are to be picking them up in the name of Jesus. We are to reconcile. It doesn't matter what their sin is, whether it's visible or non-visible. Sin is sin in God's eyes. And the church, ICC, has been given a ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. He's not counting my sin against me. That's good news. That should have been a clap right there. He's not counting your sin against you. You say, well, I'm not a bad sinner. Let me tell you, it doesn't matter if you're a bad sinner or a good sinner, you're still a sinner, and you still fell short of the glory of God. He says, and that God was reconciled, not counting people's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for me, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Wow. If that doesn't get you excited, then you'd have no appetite whatsoever. Think about it this way. If I have a heart for Jesus and desire Jesus, I will be righteous. If he's on the inside, he's going to change the outside. See, Jesus Let this sink in. If you don't get it, fill in these next three lines. If you don't get anything else, please get this. God doesn't see me the way I see myself. I grew up with an inferiority complex, feeling that I was no good. I grew up in the church. I didn't have a great testimony. I remember when I went to Bible college and I was around friends that I met there, and they had great testimonies about how God delivered them from alcohol, and God delivered one from a home that was abusive, and they had great testimonies. I didn't have a great testimony. I was raised in the church, went to Royal Rangers, Sunday school, youth ministry, went to all of that, and I just, man, I don't have a testimony. I don't have anything to offer. You begin to feel I have nothing. I'm a nobody. I'm a failure. You know, I haven't done anything. And the reality is, sometimes we're our own worst enemy. Can I have an amen? I beat myself up. Maybe you beat yourself up. You know. After Cheryl's, I've been beating myself. What did I do wrong? Maybe I gave her my blood disease. And how you begin to beat yourself up. You begin to say, man, the mess I'm in is because of situations that I've created. And I begin to feel like I'm a failure. I'm a loser. I'm a nobody. I've made a mess out of my life. I can't live for God. I can't do it. But I'm so glad this morning God doesn't see me the way I see myself. He doesn't see my garbage. He doesn't see my dirt. He doesn't see me how I see myself. And when I see that, I'm going to say, Lord, it's not my righteousness, but it's your righteousness. And I stand complete in you. He doesn't see me the way I see myself. But number two, God doesn't see me the way other people see me. He doesn't see me the way other Christians see me. He doesn't see me how the religious people see me, and they want to judge and they want to criticize, and sometimes the church does more damage with the, let me get it on TV, with the tongue. There are people who are no longer serving God today because of Christians' mouths. And God doesn't see me the way other people see me. Your family may say, you're no better, you're no good, you're never going to make it. Your husband, your wife may be unsafe, saying you're never going to make it. I don't like the way you are. I'm so glad this morning that God doesn't see me the way people see me. He doesn't see me the way my family sees me. He doesn't see me the way that others look at me and talk about my employees, people that work with me. He doesn't, man, God doesn't see me the way I see myself. He doesn't see me the way other people see me. But number three, he doesn't see me the way the devil sees me. The devil looks at me and says, you're a nobody. The devil looks at me and says, look at what your past is like, your sin, your failures. The devil looks at me and accuses God to me and accuses me to God. But friends, when God sees me, he doesn't see me the way I see myself. He doesn't see me the way people see me. He doesn't see me the way the devil sees me. But when God sees me, he sees Jesus. He sees Jesus in me. Man, if that doesn't give you a desire to please him, here's a word for somebody today. For God so loved you that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. See, the reality is I can't please God. I can't do enough good things. I think, man, I got to work another hour. I got to do more to please God. No, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. John 6:35 says, I am the bread of heaven. He that comes to me shall never hunger, and he that believes in me shall never thirst. If I come to Jesus, he will satisfy the inside. Can I have an amen? John 4:14, but whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. He says, I will give you living water. John 7:37, if any man thirst, let him come to me and drink. He that believes in me, as the scriptures has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. The winning coach at the Super Bowl gets the big jug of Gatorade poured on him. He's drenched. I'm so glad I don't need some external Gatorade bottle dumped on me. Jesus says, from the innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. What is the object of your cravings? Oh, let me give you one last thing. The satisfaction of your cravings. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. What will happen? For they shall be filled. When I'm hungry and thirsty, by the end of this service, I am starving. I'm also thinking, I know that I have 2 more hours before I can get something to eat. You know, but I can't wait to eat this afternoon. How many of us have no desire and no appetite for the presence of God? See, are we really filled? Are we filled? Are we filled? Listen to me in closing. I'm going to ask us to stand and just listen to these words in closing. As Eric begins to play. Are we filled? Are we filled?